2 days ago, Israel signed a contract with Moderna. Moderna, it's a company that's developing a new vaccine. The Israelis did not disclose for how much they made the deal. What they said in the Israeli way, we don't put all the eggs in one basket. We will make contact with other companies. But every penny is worth it, because shutting down the economy for 1 day, they lose much more money. America already, the United States government invested in Moderna, also close to $500 million. To expedite the development of the vaccine. United States also invested in a British company, AstraZeneca. I don't know why they have this strange name, AstraZeneca. Couldn't find something more normal I can remember easier. In any case, they invested $1.2 billion in this company, with a deal that they will provide 300 million doses of vaccine if and when they will develop the vaccine. I was wondering why only 300 million? There are 340 million citizens in America, but I'm sure will be 40 million citizens who don't want to be vaccinated, and 300 million should be enough. But in general, all the governments all over the world, in Israel, in England, the EU, even foundations, the Bill Gates Foundation, are throwing money all over for many companies to develop the vaccine. 200 companies claim that they're working on a vaccine, and there is over 100 vaccines in the development just now, as we talk. But Moderna is in the top of the line, and that's why everybody wants to buy the stocks of Moderna, invest in the in Moderna company, because the stock's going up and the future looks very good. All of this education, the good education I got from Howard Slater, if I made a mistake, I blame myself. He educated me much better than that. In any case, a person can ask himself, why throwing money on so many different companies? 200 companies. Better let them do some homework, find out who are the companies who have the best chance, the 3, 4, 5 companies have the best chance to develop a vaccine, and invest in them. Why throwing all of your money? The answer is simple. The more companies who work on a vaccine, the more laboratories, the more scientists will invest in it, the better chances to find the right thing as soon as possible. You never know who is going to be to develop the vaccine. It could be a scientist that nobody heard about him, sitting in a little laboratory in a city that nobody ever heard the name of. And he might save the universe better than all the big chochems. This idea that quantity will help the quality is a Jewish concept. The Talmud tells us, the Medrash tells us an amazing concept. The Medrash says 1,000 children going to school to learn the Bible. They go to Cheder to learn Chumash, 1,000 children. From this 1,000, 100 will make it to learn the Mishnah. Mishnah is the foundation of the Talmud. It's the code of Jewish law, the original code of Jewish law. From the 100 to learn Mishnah, 10 will make it to learn Gemara. That's that in general Talmud, the more complicated way of learning Torah. And one will become a rabbi who will teach, teach the code of Jewish law to our whole community. And here the Medrash is telling us how the system works. 1,000 will learn Bible, from them 100 will learn Mishnah, from them will be 10 will learn Gemara, and one will be the one. Now, a person can say, why should I waste my money? I'll go to the shtetl, or to the city, to Cleveland Heights. I look for the genius boy, the one who can learn, who I can, has a potential to become a scholar, and I invest straight in him. Why to invest in the 1,000 to learn the Bible, the Chumash? And the Rebbe is to tell it to many deans of schools, of yeshivas, says it's a condition to have the one who become a rabbi, you must have 1,000 who learn Chumash and then narrow it down to the Mishnah and Gemara. That's the way it goes. It's a game of numbers. The number game. It's you must have the 1,000. If not, you might invest in this smart boy that is now looks to you very smart and then nothing will come out. This idea that the numbers play a different, make a different, we see in the Parsha of this week. This Parsha is a famous story. Many of you know. The story of the spies, Parshat Shelach. Moses, the Jewish people came to Moses and asked him, let's send spies to spy the land of Israel. They were in the desert, just left Egypt a year and a half ago. Let's send spies to find out what the situation in Israel. Moses turned to God and asked, what should they do? God told them, do whatever you want. It's up to you, Moses. Moses decided it's a good idea. He said they will go to, we sent them to the land of Israel. They will get excited. They will tour the land. La tour et aretz, they will tour the land. They will go to Masada. They will go to the old city. They'll eat falafel in Jerusalem. They'll get excited about the place. They'll come back all full of enthusiasm and get everybody else excited. And Moses told him, you're going to the land. I want you to tour the land, to check it out. What I want, I told them an interesting line. Be courageous and take from the food and bring back from the food of the land. He wanted the Jews in the desert to see how good the food of Israel is. Even he knew that it's risking the spies. If there are a bunch of spies, if they start to schlep clusters of grapes and other food, they might be discovered. Therefore, it was so important to Moses that they should bring food. He said, be courageous and do it. They went for 40 days. And they came back. They started. The whole nation was waiting for them. For 40 days, they were waiting to hear what are the guys from Israel going to come back and tell us. The 12 spies. 10 of them started to say, the land is flowing with milk and honey. And here is the food. It's an amazing land. But, however, and here comes the however. It's a very strong, the people there are very strong, and the cities are fortified. We have no chance to make it. We will never be able to conquer it. 2 from the 12, Joshua and Caleb, they were believing in going to conquer the land. Caleb silenced the crowd, became a whole tumult. Everybody was screaming, a mob. And he said to them, listen, Moses told us in the name of God to go to the land. If Moses says we can do it, we will do it. Didn't he deliver to you and deliver until now? He gave you manna when you were hungry. He gave you water when you thirsty. He gave you the slav, some type of a meat. Did he ever let you down, Moses? Give him another chance. Give him a chance. So far, he lived up to everything he said. But the people didn't want to hear what Moses has to say. People listen to what, people hear whatever they want to hear. They didn't listen to what Caleb had to say. And they started to cry. The whole nation was crying that night. And they said to each other, let's appoint a leader and go back to Egypt. A year and a half ago, they left Egypt. After wonders and miracles, 10 plagues, the splitting of the sea, after so much suffering in Egypt, a year and a half later, they forgot about everything. Let's go back to Egypt. God turned to Moses and he tells Moses, I want to wipe out this old people and start from you, Moses, a new nation. Moses right away started to pray to God. What he said to God, he gave God the best argument. What are the Egyptians going to say when they will hear that what you did? They will say, you took them out from Egypt to slaughter them in the desert? For this you took them out? What is the world going to say about you, God? God accepted this argument and he told Moses, I will forgive them. But however, now it's God's however, they will live in the desert. This generation will stay in the desert for 40 years and they will die out in the desert. And when they will be done, the next generation will enter the land of Israel. And that's actually what happened. The 10 spies died on the spot. The rest of this generation between 20 and 60, the men only, died out over a period of 4 years, and the next generation entered the land of Israel. That's the story. But you listen to the, you read the story and you ask yourself, what's going on here? A total failure. God with Moses together sends the best of the Jewish people. The 12 spies were not just regular guys. They were the leaders of the tribes. Nesi'im. And the Bible says, Echad lamateh, Echad lamateh. Literally it means one per tribe. But the word Echad, twice, is utilized. The Kabbalah tells us, Echad lamateh means they were connected to the Echad. Which Echad we know? Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. This Echad, they were connected to God. Holy, righteous people. And then they come in such a failure, such a disaster, nothing. And why even to write the story? It's just a, that God and Moses with the whole, and everything, nothing good. A total failure, in vain. And I heard a talk from the Rebbe. I heard a tape from 1978. And the Rebbe speaks, asked this question, and he said something very interesting. He said, these people, it was, the mission was not in vain. These 12 people actually paved the way for the next generation to go to Israel. Here is a group, they actually went to Israel. They had the wrong conclusions, but they were there. They brought some food back. They started the beginning. They were the pioneers. Will we see it more? We see it in the Haftorah of this parsha. The Haftorah is always a similar story to the story of the parsha. The Haftorah tells us about Joshua. Right after Moses died, in the middle of the Shiva, Joshua sent messengers, spies, to spy the land of Israel. He sent two spies to spy Jericho. Who were the two spies, the Talmud tells us? One of them was Caleb. Remember Caleb, the same guy who tried to convince the Jewish nation to go to Israel and they didn't want to listen? This time, Joshua chose them to be the spies. Why are you sending a guy who is 78 years old? He couldn't find anybody younger to be a spy. But he sent them because he was from the first group that was chosen by Moses. He wanted one of them, of those who were there already, to go again and to check things out. And what we see here is the same story. It was 12, Moses chose 12 people, sent them. From all the 12, one actually made it. He went again. And because of him, they conquered the land of Israel. From 1,000, you get out one. From the 12 leaders that Moses has chose, one of them made it eventually into the land of Israel. You know, everybody wants to invest in the stocks of Moderna. I have an idea for you. How about to invest in the stocks of 1,000 going to school, Jewish education? The best return for our money is when you invest in Jewish education, because these kids will continue the Jewish tradition and they will eventually grow to be strong Jewish activists and they will give and give to the Jewish community more in money in other ways. But that's not, I'm not here for a fundraiser. Judaism, you know, every parent tells his child, learn a profession that's a recession-proof profession. Be a doctor, no matter what, you need a doctor. If it's recession or no recession, everybody needs a doctor, a lawyer, other type of professions like this. The most recession-proof thing in the world is Judaism. Judaism was relevant 3,000 years ago, relevant in any country, in every place. It was relevant before COVID-19, during COVID-19, and after COVID-19. It's always been relevant. And investing in Judaism doesn't mean money. It means invest yourself in Judaism. Make another mitzvah, learn more Torah. This is much more, it's easier to reach, cheaper, and always will serve you right. That's what Judaism is all about. Let's invest ourselves in Judaism, and then we will always reap the benefits.